Here we have a variable s created at the outer scope, and at the inner scope we have a variable t which is an integer 5. We then make s a reference to t. This compiles at the time, but the problem with this is that when t goes out of scope, all its references become invalid. Now s becomes invalid. If we try to print the value of s, then we get an error. Rust figures this out using lifetimes. Each variable has a lifetime associated with the scope in which it was created. Here, s has a lifetime which we'll call a, and t has a lifetime which we'll call b. When we assign s a reference to t, Rust compares the lifetime of s and t and sees that the lifetime of s is longer than that of t. Most times, we do not need to specify the lifetime of a reference, but to use a reference in a struct and sometimes in a function, you would need to specify the lifetimes of the references. Let's look at the functions below to understand how and why to specify lifetimes in a function. For the first example, we try to return a reference for a variable created inside this function. But when the function scope ends, the variable x is dropped and the reference becomes invalid. So this function returns an invalid reference, therefore it wouldn't compile. If the function returns a reference that is not static, then it should come from one of its parameters. The purpose of lifetimes in functions is to inform the compiler how the lifetime of its output values relates to the lifetime of its input parameters. We shall see this in the coming examples. For the second example, we return x from the function's parameter, which is the reference of an integer. It compiles successfully as the compiler assigns the lifetime of the return value of this function to that of x from its parameter. But when we have two reference parameters and an output which is a reference, the compiler has no way of knowing how the lifetime of the output reference relates to that of the input. For the third example, here we have two parameters. Now the compiler cannot figure out which lifetime to assign the return value of the function, so we manually add a lifetime to the function. We label the lifetime of a reference by adding an apostrophe after the ampersand, followed by the letter we choose to label it with in small cases. To add a lifetime in a function, we specify the label of the lifetimes used in the function in an angle bracket, then give each reference parameter and return values their lifetimes after their ampersand. Now this tells the compiler that the return value lives as long as both parameters live. If one of the two is dropped, the output of the function is dropped too. In some situations, the lifetime of the return value only relates to some and not all the lifetime of the input parameters. For the fourth example, we return x from the parameter, and we want to specify that the lifetime of the return value only relates to that of the first parameter. So we add two lifetimes a and b for the function. We label the lifetime of x with a and that of y with b. Since the lifetime of the return value relates to that of x, we label its lifetime with a as well. If we try to return y, we get an error since the lifetime of y and the return value are different. To see this further, in the main function we have a variable x and z at the outer scope and y at the inner scope. At the inner scope, we assign z to be the return value of the function. Outside the inner scope, we print the value of z and this compiles successfully since the lifetime of z is tied to that of x at the first parameter. If y is at the first and x is at the second, the lifetime of y will be tied to the return value of the function. And when we try to use z outside the scope of y, we get an error. For the fifth example, here we have one reference parameter and the return value is a tuple containing two integer references. We do not need to explicitly specify the lifetimes as the compiler assumes that any reference in the output comes from this one parameter, So this compiles successfully without any errors. For the sixth example, instead of just one reference parameter, we have two reference parameters. The compiler has no idea how the reference in the output relates to that of the input. The two references in the output can come from the first, the second, or both. In our implementation, the first element of the tuple comes from the first parameter, while the second element of the tuple comes from the second parameter. To specify this in lifetimes, since we are dealing with two different lifetimes, we add two lifetime labels to the function, and the lifetime we give to the first parameter we give to the first element of the tuple. And we do that for the second parameter and the second tuple. The next lifetime to talk about is the static lifetime. This is a lifetime of a variable that can live for the entire duration of the program. All string and byte literals have a static lifetime, since they are stored in the program's binary, which is always available. Unlike our first example, this program compiles, since the return value of this function can live as long as the program. We just have to specify that the lifetime of the return value is static using the static lifetime. To use a reference in a struct that isn't a static lifetime, we have to specify the lifetime used in the struct in an angle bracket as well. When creating method for this struct, we add after the impl keyword as well. Thanks for watching.